Here in Western New England.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 at 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Hit 11 on the nose.
from somebody who's completely...
I was in another world here.
Yep. My mic is up.
Yeah, it's working.
It sounds different today.
No, it's fine.
It does?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
You look a little crotchety today, my friend.
Let me change your EQ a little bit.
Oh.
I look what?
You look crotchety. You're kind of crotchety today.
Cranky. There's a hum. I hear a hum.
Do you hear that? Do you hear that crotchety?
There's no hum here.
I was going to say, do you hear that crotch?
Are you plugged in all the way?
Yeah. Oh, here we go.
There's no hum here.
All right.
Yeah, I'm getting a hum.
Maybe it's your stuff.
Keep talking amongst yourselves.
Oh, my God. Help me.
All right, Bob, we'll just keep talking.
This is great radio, isn't it, folks? Where do I look? Do I look at that straight
camera? Yeah, you're looking at the straight camera. Yeah.
Okay, got it. Get fabulous.
I have a very slight hum there.
There's nothing here.
I'm trying.
I'm hearing nothing in my monitors.
That might be my stomach.
It's a 60 hertz hum.
A 60 hertz hum.
I'm hearing nothing in my monitors here. I got nothing.
You know, folks, there's nothing like television like this or radio like this. This is stuff you don't see on Regis and Kathy Lee.
Well, because they have a budget.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
And it's driving me nuts.
Oh, that hum is driving you nuts. I can't even hear it. Oh, that's better.
Is it better?
I think that the hum is
yes.
good.
It's
Look
better?
Look at you.
So it's your monitors?
Must have been the monitor. I don't know. I must have done the whole show.
Yeah, that's a fancy schmancy monitor.
Somebody was humming during my show then the entire time. I didn't even notice it, folks. At any rate.
I paid a lot of good money for this in-ear monitor.
Ah.
And it's in... You don't hear the hum when I plug that one in?
No.
No. So the idea here is you've spent a lot of money to be to get a lot of angst from your hum. Whatever that means.
Keep talking.
Keep talking. Folks, I was born about 77 years ago in a cabin in the wilds of Kentucky, way up on a mountaintop. One morning,
Steve Martin, all of a sudden,
One morning I awoke to discover that I was a radio television personality on a very, very tiny scale.
Hey, remember those test probes I was looking for?
Holy mother, be afraid!
See what's in your bags?
Oh, What else you got in your bag there, Matt?
Is the ATEM controller still .35.149?
I think so.
What are you looking?
Why?
Listen,
I found out where I wrote down that IP address.
Ah, gotcha.
I'm finding everything I want except for what I need.
For the folks who are listening on the radio, for the folks who are listening on the radio, let's give them a treat. To let them know that you
set the
are
scene, Bob.
Well, we've got Kenny Stompson going through his bag over there, looking for something. Apparently,
it's my bag of tricks.
Well, what are you looking for in your bag that is so important that we need to spend and waste valuable time on our radio show?
It's no longer our radio show. It's mine.
Oh, sorry, I forgot.
I'm looking for a eighth-inch to eighth-inch, otherwise known as a 3.5 to 3.5 female-to-female adapter.
Uh-huh.
And that has nothing to do about what you were talking about this morning.
Oh, no. Well, I'm wondering if you could actually...
You know what? I'm going to live with the hum.
All right. Yes. Please live with the hum. Please live, though. We'll talk over the hum. Let's see if I can talk
to you. I'm pretty sure the female-to-female adapter would fix it. Because that would isolate the third ring or the fourth conductor on that male plug.
Uh-huh. I don't know what it is. It's National Turtle Day. Do you know they breathe out of their rear ends? Did you know that? We learned that on my show.
I know a lot of people who think and talk out of their rear ends.
Hmm.
Kathy's going to be late today.
Silence.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Kathy's going to be late. What? Yep. So what's happening, my friend? Tell me.
I tell you, I'm all right now, but last week I was in rough shape.
Really? Why?
I've always said for years, I enjoy editing, you know, doing post-production work on videos.
Oh, okay. Yeah, of course.
And
you're good at it.
It's relaxing.
Yeah.
And this weekend, I got hung up on a couple of things, and I really got fed up with Adobe Premiere Pro.
Adobe Premiere Pro, you guys, is a program. Internet program?
No, not internet program, just it's a video production program.
A video production.
Industry standard.
Okay, gotcha. Okay, so go ahead.
And I got fed up with it. And I had to stop and walk away. And
you were angry at
Adobe. And then yesterday afternoon.
Yeah.
Oh, well, look what the cat dragged in. See what I did there? She was dealing with a cat. And now the cat drags her in.
This is not something that people on the radio would be.
Oh, this is a dumpster fire of a broadcast right now. I will admit it.
Holy mother.
When she doesn't show up.
We could start again right from the very top.
Control you?
Well, no. It's just that we spent the first 10 minutes.
Don't be surprised by Mark coming in. He's got to get some speakers.
I'm here.
Okay. So we've got Ken Stomsky's program for the last 15 minutes has been Ken looking for some kind of adapter and then complaining about Adobe Pro.
It's been
a dumpster fire.
I do know what that means, just in case you're trying to do it to me again.
Do you think that
I know what you mean. So there.
Is anybody at all listening to this jibber-jabber?
No, I'm watching Mark move some speakers.
All right, let's start over.
All right, we're starting over. Help me.
I'm talking about Ken Stomsky's wiki program. Kathy Palmer, too. The Dan Marver for you. Discussions of logo and happenings, too. You got the Ken Stomsky weekly program with Kathy Palmer, too.
This is great.
Okay, we're good.
Oh my God.
Hey, look at this. 819 on the nose.
On the nose.
Welcome.
You had one of your old broadcasts come pop up somewhere on social media, one of them way back when we were up at the college, mm-hmm. and you hit it right on the nose. I was so proud when I heard that. A legacy that we continue.
This is a wonderful tape. Who was your recorder, or who sang that song, and tell us about
DJ Corona.
That's DJ Corona.
BJ.
BJ Corona.
Yeah. Bruce
J. Yeah. Corona.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
And didn't that make your day better, Bob, for knowing that?
I love that. I know. I mean, you've got your own theme song. Mine is stolen from Lin-Manuel Miranda. And I love my theme song, but that one, holy mother, and Kathy Palmer, too.
And Kathy Palmer, too, who finally caught the cat. I'm so excited.
Oh, man. You really out there? Indoors trying to catch trying to catch
this house was indoors. Bob, this has been going on for over a month that I've been trying to trap these cats. So it
How
is,
many
it
cats?
Is oh, I don't even want to know. I don't even want to know. But needless
Your
to say, oh, I have a question for you. And you would know this, Ken. Who is the city councilor for the old burying grounds? Is that Ralph?
Ralph.
Ward 2.
Who's
the Figgy.
Ralph Figgy. Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. We were trying to decide that last night at the commission meeting, and we weren't exactly sure. We thought it was, but we weren't exactly
the
sure.
The historic...
historical commission.
Yeah, what west side of Elm Street over Figgy?
Okay.
Or east side of Elm Street over Figgy, and then west side is Matthews Kane.
Bridget, okay.
Yep.
All right, thank you very much. We appreciate it. Our gate has been repaired finally.
My gosh, yeah. For years, for weeks now, I've been driving by and I'm going, this looks awful. And will they find the money? So
it's all done. It's all done. It's completed. Thank you, Peter, by the way.
For what?
Well, your brother did an absolutely wonderful job, so we thank you for putting us in touch with him.
No problem. I looked at the good work.
He did a great job, Peter, and he was, this is Peter's brother. Is it Broderfens, Peter?
Broder Campbell, yeah.
Yeah, he
the craftsman that actually did it is Tommy O'Sullivan.
Tommy O'Sullivan.
Who I've known since I was a little kid.
And you know, they were able, Peter, to use every single piece. They found piece.
Yep.
They put it back together. Finials were literally, for those of you who don't know.
Tommy's a super talented metal worker and welder.
It was wonderful. Yeah. The old burying grounds down on Mechanic Street, Westfield is lucky to have one of the oldest cemeteries, or burying grounds, not cemetery, still in its original spot in the country. There are others older, but they've been moved.
Yeah.
And we had just completed refurbishing the gates for a considerable sum of money. And last year, Halloween weekend, someone literally came down Chapel Street, never stopped, and went crashing right into the gates. And whoever it was, when they pulled out, there were things dragging. So they
It was a hit and run?
It was a hit and run.
It was
caught on camera, but when it was too far away to get any we couldn't get any identification. The scary part, Bob, was there was a worker, if you remember, they've been working on the rails to trails up there.
Yeah.
There was a railroad worker coming down that street, and he just missed T-boning him. I mean, the man, and he saw it. The man saw the whole thing. He was a witness. But it crashed the gate. It just broke it to smithereens. So thank you, and thank you to Community Preservation, because they were able to help us with some funding. And we want to thank a friend of ours, Cece, thank her very much, because she also was a private citizen who started a GoFundMe. So they are back, they're up and running, and we will have a dedication on June 17th. One more quick thing, auditions tonight at the Westfield Theater Group for Arsenic and Old Lace.
I know, Michael Buster McMahon shaved his beard to audition for that show.
Yes, he did. He was there last night. I talked to him. Yep.
Well, are you directing the show?
No. I am not directing it. Stuart Gamble is directing it.
And are you in it?
I am not in it.
Because you've done that show before. You played one of the aunts.
No, I did not.
I swear you were.
I might have been one of the original aunts back in the 40s, but.
Oh.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
What was the lighting like in the auditorium? Not auditorium.
The theater.
The theater then. How did you project all that candlelight?
Oh, we had
Wow.
Okay. All right.
Didn't that gas light get a little dangerous working with?
Burn.
Back in the 40s when you were playing Arsenic and Old Lace.
Arsenic and Old Lace. Yeah, yes, burying the bodies.
Yeah. I swear I saw you playing that role.
No, you did not see me playing the role. I haven't played a role in a while. The last role I did was Mrs. Higgins in My Fair Lady. After that, no way. I take that back. I've done some one acts over at Exit 7.
That's true.
I haven't done much.
Yeah.
And of course, our duo presentation, yours and mine, Adam and Eve.
Oh my God! Yeah, that's right. Okay. Hey, whose show are we on?
I don't know. Is somebody else here today? Oh, Ken!
Ben.
Oh, hi, Ken! We didn't know you were coming. How's your male and female doing over there?
I really wish I had the female-to-female coupler right now.
That would be a problem.
Just to satisfy my thought on how to alleviate the slight
hum
that I'm getting.
I don't hear a hum.
No, you're not. It's something to do with this monitor I have. And you know, it's like an aluminum body. I mean, it's not a cheap monitor.
No, I know it's not, but it's happening today. Did it happen before?
Don't know. I might be overly sensitive today, but I tried tapping it into your outlet, and I'm still getting a hum. I think it's because, if you take a look, that has four conductors on it, because there's a microphone here somewhere.
Hey, Kenny, I just got an email from Attorney General Merrick Garland.
Really?
Yes.
What did we do?
In my city email.
Oh.
It says that there's a fund waiting for me, but I got to reply right away with my full name, address, phone number, email address, occupation, and next of kin.
Jeez, I never get those grant giveaways down in Southwick.
We'll get another warning, won't we?
You know, maybe that could fund a couple of trips down to Florida, down to Kennedy.
I sent that to our IT director and go, yeah. This one made me chuckle.
Well,
Merritt Garland is giving the
Bob, it's a scam.
Oh, Bob.
Oh, all right. Okay. Oh, all right. Listen, there are a lot of scams out there. I had the
Bob would send all the information and go, why is my bank account drained?
Yeah, Internal Revenue.
Why has my house been remortgaged?
Yeah, the Internal Revenue folks called me last night to tell me that I had a refund that I hadn't claimed.
I know.
I said, forget it. I said, this is a scam. Bye.
Think about that, though.
Don't
in this,
it. Don't
where the economy is going in the tank, right? Anybody, free money, people are like, oh, they'll do anything for free money. You know,
I think you're right.
They're very smart about it.
Yeah. And it does. And it happens a lot, Peter, to the elderly because at our age, we're not as sharp and we're not as technological as some people.
And
are.
All it takes is you're going to go to jail. Give me your name and address or we're going to come and pick you up. And immediately you're giving their name, address, social.
That caused a rift in my family.
Show up with a warrant.
Why?
Yeah. Well, you know, I was out. You know, I have one brother. You know, somewhat estranged a bit for years, but then all of a sudden, a couple of years ago, those scams started coming up, calling his house. So now he's calling my father, that deadbeat brother of mine, and I'm like, these are scams, all right.
Yeah.
You know, I have an 841 credit rating, all right. I don't owe anyone anything.
Oh, those credit rating. Your credit rating is give us your information and we'll change your credit. Oh, God.
And I'm like, these are scams. And then they call up the following day. He's like, he works for the city now? Well, I'm going to tell everybody to call the mayor every time I get a call like this.
Oh, yeah. All right. But
it caused, it's not just...
It's on the phone, but it's also
it's not
on
just
your
scamming
computer.
People. But
don't you think that
I can't be the only family out there where something like that is happening?
Do you get pop-ups on your computer that are also scams?
No, because that? I don't surf those types of websites. You do, Bob?
No.
Oh, I don't do that at all. James is always complaining, and I'm saying, get off the damn website.
Well, Peter and I have to take these security exams and testing and training. Peter, do you have to do that?
Yes. Kenny's didn't work, though, for some reason.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Maybe because you're on the westfieldtv.org domain.
Yeah, it could be, but I clicked to take the exams.
And it wouldn't let
And
you.
It was like, sorry, we think this is suspicious. We won't open it for you.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's your email browser.
Mike.
You have to whitelist the sender. That's why.
And the city
emails
sketchy. If you don't go on it every so often, then you have to re-sign up.
Well, I had time 2.5 weeks to take that exam, but now I won't have enough time for another 2.5 weeks.
Oh well, you're gonna have to do it because you have to.
I think your money is dependent on it.
Just cut and paste
your salary.
Yeah, there are certain things that you have to do to apply for things, but I don't think it's not mandatory, Peter, is it? I do it.
It isn't. It actually helps our insurance.
And I have no problem doing it. I could probably write half of it.
Well, you could probably
but the thing is, when I had, an extra hour to get into it
takes time.
It wouldn't work.
Hmm.
Remember, I'm working three jobs, honey.
There are glitches. There's a couple, Peter, where you have to choose one of the answers, and sometimes when you choose it doesn't want to click. You have to try it a few times.
I say it's been fine on my computer.
It's glitchy.
Yeah, and one time I took an exam like that, I actually found an incorrect answer to a question.
Really?
It said, I answered it correctly.
And they said no?
No. I wrote an email explaining it, didn't hear back. So.
Bob, this is a training that it is requested that all of us that are on the city email that we take to avoid being scammed and getting problems in with the email. So they request it strenuously. I mean, if you don't do it, no one's going to come.
God, wouldn't it be great if we could do that for private citizens?
Well, you can do that. You can go online and Google things to look out for. It's not a difficult thing. And there are emails that you shouldn't open. There's one that goes around on messaging on social media, and it says, look at this video. I think it's someone you know. Don't do it. Don't do it. In general, if somebody pops up on my email and I haven't heard from them in 3 years, I'm not opening.
What about those, those Instagram?
Especially if you're dead.
Oh, yeah. Really. Twitter or Instagram that they come up and it goes, how are you doing? And I'm saying, why does
don't
she
do
care? This woman that hasn't seen me in 50 years.
Right. That's probably a scam.
And she's going to say, how are you doing?
Yep. It's a scam.
It's a scam.
I get things from PayPal, asking me to upgrade my account.
Oh, my God.
I don't have a PayPal account.
Walmart or Amazon, your shipment is due tomorrow.
Yep.
Click here to track it.
No.
Or what's that, the other one, Microsoft, coming up on my machine saying you have to update that, and it won't go away. You can't, and you try to get rid of it, and then you have to work really
hard.
Well,
you're on XP or Windows 98, you might see those.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. That's terrible. Terrible.
Mm-hmm.
I need a whole new system. I need a whole.
You just got a whole new system.
I know.
Just got a laptop a year or so ago, didn't you?
Yeah, about 2 years ago. Yeah.
Oh, 2 years. Yeah, that's end of life.
Mine is 10 years old.
Holy
it is.
Mother.
It is. It's 10 years old. You know, the only thing I do everything on my phone. The only thing I use the laptop for is writing scripts. So.
I keep changing memory and hard drive in these things. So.
I need to change my memory.
I found that with some of the older computers. Some of the older computers, like we have some older machines that are still running like PC 3 memory, which is now they're up to PC 5. Mm. But I swapped out the old hard drive and put in the solid state hard drive. We have those, you know, we use them for recording video here. And then I tried to upgrade the memory to a current and they run great.
Yeah.
Like one of them's pushing all three of my live baseball cameras out in the other room.
Interesting.
And it still just chugs along.
Peter, I have that old gigantic 900-pound computer in my back room, and that sucker will still fire up. I mean,
you mean you have a computer that has a hard drive on the floor?
No, you know, remember the great big monitors that were this
big? Yeah, of course I do.
CRTs.
Yes, I still have one. I keep meaning to toss it. But
oh, my God. Call the Goodwill. They'll come and pick it up. There must be something that...
No, Holy Trinity is doing a technology recycling drive.
Ah, good
and that's
idea.
Usually when I
take out that hard drive and smash it up so that nobody can... See your web history. Trust me, you don't want anyone to see your web history.
This is from the 1990s.
I was on that computer. You don't want anyone to see that web history.
Hey.
is from the 90s. I don't even think we had a web history then.
Kenny, I got a question then. What about all my old cell phones? What do I do with those? And that I haven't uploaded or whatever.
Places if you wipe them, you can donate them.
Exactly. You do a factory factory reset on it, and I believe any police department will take them in for.
Or you can give it to me, and I'll use it for a prop. Honestly, I do.
Battered women's shelters, things
exactly,
like that.
Exactly. Yeah.
I use them for props.
Yeah. And the reason why is they might not necessarily set up an account, so somebody gets a free phone to be chatting on, but those phones will always dial out to a 911.
So, but how do I scratch the
Google is your friend.
Google is your friend.
I should bring you all of my phones, and you. But how do we?
If you know I'm 55 an hour.
I don't know.
Oh, listen, I have that money. I put it aside for you.
But you Google the model number, factory reset, and then it gives you a procedure and. Boom, everything's gone.
It does. It does.
Yeah.
It's just a reboot.
But it's the same number. I mean, like, I got to remember the number.
Depending on the technology you have T-Mobile. So what you need to do is remove your SIM card. Because the SIM card is your ID, not the phone.
Oh, here we go.
So if I remove my SIM card from every one of my phones, and I save my SIM card.
Well, your call list... your contact list, your texts could still be on the phone. You still need to do a factory wipe. But your identity on at least a T-Mobile phone or an AT&T phone. Or
Verizon, it's internal SIM, now they're eSIM.
Yeah, Verizon is a TDMA technology, not GSM. So they don't have the SIM card. They require more of a subscriber module number and a EISN.
Okay, you lost me at SIM card. SIM card I got. Anything beyond that, I'm done. I'm done.
Where are we?
Bob, just nod and look like we know what he's talking about. Just go, yes, Ken, we thought that.
Yes, Ken, we thought that.
Yes, we did.
Yes, Ken, we thought that.
All right, then why'd you ask?
I have no idea. You haven't done a rant today. Do you have a rant prepared?
No, and I don't have a rant because, as I was talking earlier, my puss has been shoved into Premiere Pro for the past 3 weeks, and I just haven't had time for anything.
Right. Well, I hate to have your puss shoved.
I'm out of this.
So, you know, I got frustrated with Premiere Pro this weekend, and as I was saying to Bob, you know, I enjoy Premiere Pro. Premiere Pro by Adobe is a video editing.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, industry standard.
Okay. Gotcha.
So I was saying to him earlier, I started to, you know, I've always said I enjoy sitting down and editing a video. I love doing post-production work. I can get creative and just come up with, you know, maybe a different effect every time I go out to do something, to do a project. And Peter, to a point, enjoys a little bit of editing like that too, but I really get into it, and it relaxes me and it makes me feel good. Well,
I like to edit, but I have less time than you to dig into a project. Like, there's still stuff I'd like to get finished editing. I just don't have the time.
Yeah. So
I need to take a vacation just to do the editing.
So now I got that project I started several weeks ago down in Virginia. I've got 90 gig worth of video, which is about 30 hours worth of coverage.
Wow.
And I got to get that under 2 hours, but make it meaningful and have it tell a story, you know, have a good storyline, blah, blah, blah. So here I am in the middle of the weekend, and I just got stumped on something. I was having a problem with chroma key. Basically, what I did is you don't always have to have a green wall like we have here in order to key something
out. Actually, I've tried that in other different colors, like we did over at Boys and Girls Club.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The best colors to key are green and blue.
Green and blue. But it is possible to key if you have another solid color there, so long as your subject doesn't have any of those colors.
Right.
So, you know, I'm at a hotel room. I've got a plain beige wall in the hotel room. I'm like, well, that's going to be good because I couldn't carry a green screen down with me. So now I'm editing. I'm working on it. What happens? All the girls' complexions.
Holy mother. All you see is eyes and mouth.
I'm starting to key out with the wall.
Oh.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, I didn't even think of that.
Yep.
Because I made sure I didn't have any shadows. It was completely solid. You know, I knew it was a good wall to key off of, but their complexions just threw everything off. So
I would not think of that.
I got really fed up, and I'm trying to come up with ways around it. And I'm like, you know what? There has to be a way of removing a subject from any type of background. Along comes Adobe After Effects, another part of the Adobe suite.
Mm-hmm.
And this thing has to do something. Come to find out, and I found it. There's a thing called a roto tool.
Like roto?
Not a roto tool, a roto brush. A roto brush.
Uh-huh.
And it takes a while to be really precise to go around your subject. But now you trace around the subject, and then you start the roto brush, and it goes frame by frame, and it wipes out everything in that frame except for what you've outlined to keep. So luckily now, I'm already starting with a beige wall in the background. So it's easy enough to cut out the subject. Because I interviewed, you know, like 15, 18 kids or whatever. Multiple questions. I need this footage. So the roto brush tool, it takes a little bit to run, and then you have to freeze it. And then that does it locks that in frame by frame by frame. But then I get the subject with a clear background. And I can either keep that clear background or I can put up a chroma green or a chroma blue or whatever behind them and then I decided to go with a clear background because now I can take that subject and put it over anything I want, which is cool. And when I figured that out on Sunday afternoon, I was woo-hooing in my house. You know, I clapped my hands. I'm like,
I could hear you. Because, I could hear you.
Well, what I did was I tested it out. Once I saw that I could do that,
yeah.
I then tested it out, and I put the subject on top of material that I wanted, and I'm looking at it. I'm like, oh, man, this is really cool. It's going to add another week to the project.
Something we are not going to try doing, Bob.
No.
But it was just so damn cool.
Just type
cool.
in and print. That's me. Yeah. Type in, print. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I wasn't in the center.
I haven't even looked because I don't care.
All right. So where are
Not
we?
Today.
I have 19 more minutes before I have to sum
What are you
up.
Watching now?
Oh, well, I'm... Oh, I've got it. Oh, no. I. You know what?
What?
I haven't seen Ryan and... Kelly and Scott. Mark.
Her husband, Mark. Mark.
I haven't seen it once, and I refuse. I didn't watch American Idol this year. So I have no idea.
Are you on a Seacrest boycott?
I think I am. I think I've over Kelly Ripa and Ryan Seacrest.
Now and then I'll just keep it on that channel because it's better than watching the third hour of Good Morning America.
Oh, God.
I don't watch either. I'm not up that early.
Yeah. The Today program, how about that? Is that any good? The third hour of Today?
Well, you know, whatever's
on tonight.
Oh, look, you could watch Rachel
well,
Ray.
Working,
That's
Peter.
10.
Oh, that's
True.
10 o'clock. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. No, what am I...
Actually, there's some type of judge show on that.
Judge Steve Harvey or Judge...
No.
Steve, or,
no, not, n- neither of those.
Yeah. I have been watching some great stuff. There is a wonderful miniseries on Anne Frank. It's on the Disney Channel and on Hulu, called A Small Light. But it's not on Anne Frank. It's on me.
You know what? That's on one of the public channels, too, one of the world's channels.
It's really wonderful, yeah. And it's about the woman who helped her. Miles Jeep. Oh,
yes.
God.
I've seen it. I haven't watched it.
Oh, it is so wonderful.
Is it
you
good?
Gotta. It's excellent. 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 I also love this show called Our Flag Means Death, which is a pirate show about relationships. Very funny. Very, very poignant. And worth seeing. Yeah, arg. And so those two I would recommend.
He's going over. You know, he's going over his notes from his own show. Stop it. I've got my stuff here.
Oh,
I'm so sorry. Sorry.
Kevin?
Quit it.
Did you want to say something?
Stop it. I now have it in front of me.
You have an obit over there. Oh, God.
Yeah.
Who died?
Aria lost someone very well-known last week.
I don't know this person.
Chris Sanders passed away. I've known him for over 30 years. He's been a disc jockey, a karaoke host.
Okay.
He sang in the choir in school when he went to Southwick High. So he passed away at the age of 64 last week.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh. So young.
Yeah. Like I said, I've known him 30 years.
Yeah.
So just want to say so long, Chris. You know, it's a pleasure knowing you. You will be missed.
Sorry about that. Yeah.
I got to talk to Pete about that later on,
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
So I have something else here.
What do you have?
I don't get it. All right.
This is not going to be
the business section of the Republican, although they're one of the most liberal papers in the area.
So what?
I don't get that either.
No, you're right.
You know, I remember one time I was working up in Northampton, and somebody who just moved into the area came into the shop. They go, you know, what do we get for newspapers around here? I go, well, you have two. You have the Daily Hampshire Gazette, and you have the Republican, the big one from Springfield. Oh, the Republican, not going to read that. I go, well, if you move to Northampton, I'm willing to bet you probably want to read the Republican.
Well, the Republican is not a Republican paper. It's it talks about the Republic. It's one of the oldest papers in the country and one of the most historic papers in the country. Have a lot to do with the
I know that.
Yeah. All right, go for it, Ken.
So in the business section in you know, they like to be called Mass Live now too.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Like that helps. Americans are holding onto their vehicles longer than ever. Right? So the article goes.
Jeez, it could be because the economy's in the tank or anything.
Well, I don't understand something in this. Americans are keeping their cars longer than ever. The average age of a passenger vehicle on U.S. roads hit a record 12.5 years this year.
Wow.
Sedans are even older, on average 13.6. That doesn't seem very old.
12 years?
It is
12.5 years.
It is to me.
Wait a minute. Most of
my cars all my life, and I've had well-paying jobs, were 4 or 5 years to begin with when I bought them, and you have them another, you know, 6, 10 years, and they're still in good shape. I mean, the average age is 12. Who the hell are these people buying cars? Are they beating the hell out of them? No. Are they driving them into the ground?
Well, I no. I would say this: that
is Obama pouring stuff into the crankcase to the engine.
3 years of that.
Don't, Bob.
3 years of that was the coronavirus crisis, during which.
Then you want to keep your car even longer.
Because it wasn't on the road. That's why you were able to keep the car longer.
But so 12.5 years does not sound.
I would say those are 9.5 years.
I would. My 2009 lasted me to 2020, and it's still running because my girlfriend's daughter is driving it.
Drink. Why not?
My Chevy is an 05.
Wait a minute. Drink.
Yes, we've met.
I wasn't paying attention there. My newest car is an 05. Do the math.
I try not to keep a car more than 5 years. Only because I...
Well, maybe you're privileged then.
I want to get some payback when I trade it in. I don't want to be paying thousands and thousands of...
How about not paying anything for a car until...
Until it dies and then you're stuck buying a new one.
Yeah.
I don't want to do that. Yeah. My dad was a car salesman.
I haven't had a car payment in 10 years.
I don't have car payments. I never have car payments.
You're driving around
then
a Cadillac.
I guess you're privileged then.
I guess so.
You are privileged.
I'm such a princess.
That's why I read this, and you're like, oh, I don't get it.
There are those of us out there.
You're blessed with a new vehicle every 5 years. I mean, and I'm shocked that 12 and a half years is the average age of.
Well, to defend Kathy, you do mortgaging or whatever they call it, financing with your car.
No, I don't.
You pay for the car outright every 5 years?
Yeah.
Privileged.
I do.
Gods, richer than I thought.
I could barely afford a major repair right now.
But keep in mind that I had a good trade-in. Because I don't keep my car very long, so I get a very good trade-in, which reduces the price of my car.
But still, $10,000 or $20,000 is a lot of money.
Nah, it's only money. I would rather pay for it than pay to borrow money, because when you finance, you're paying to borrow money, aren't you?
Yeah.
So why would I do that?
No, it's true. Why except you that? Want something and you
except
need it.
Now I can't
I have
just
friends,
go out and sell a cow.
They're always telling me I got it. I've got a new car. I got a new car. Every 2 years they get a new car. They refinance. And they're always paying into that. But they always have a new car. And some folks even lease a car over and over.
You know, we looked
again.
Into the leasing, and leasing is great. It's great if you don't have the money up front to buy one.
Yeah.
It's great if you can't get a loan. It's great if you always want a brand new car. But the problem with leasing is when you're done, you're done. You have nothing to show for it. The car goes back and you're finished. That's what I don't like about leasing. But I've had friends who've done that and they're very happy with it. So who cares? Now, keep in mind, your old car happens to be a Cadillac. That's a little different there, buddy. You know, It's not like driving this old clunky junky thing around town.
Well, it is a clunky junky thing. I've seen it. It's not. I mean, like, your car is a lovely Cadillac, but it's not. It's not like when you drive by, I'm going to go, wow, look at that Cadillac.
Nobody does that.
Maybe, I don't. Do they? Or maybe, oh, look at that. That I know when an old car drives by, I usually go, oh, my God, look at that old Mercury. Look at that. Well, I wouldn't say. I wouldn't know a Mercury from or whatever. look at that old, beautiful
Chevy
sports car.
Ford.
Look at that,
I still have a hood ornament on this thing that'll stab you in the chest if I hit you with it.
They don't even do those anymore.
That's why.
We have the bulldog.
We have a bulldog somewhere.
Uh-huh. Love it.
Yeah. They've stopped putting.
All right. So I would probably go, wow, look at that hood ornament on Kenny's car.
Yeah.
I like the color of his car. I like that deep, deep color.
Mm-hmm. Is it out there? Can I look at it when I go out?
It's out there.
Yeah.
It's out there. Uh-huh. And it's distinctive. When I see it go by, I know that's him. Of course, he ignores me completely and just keeps on going, but that's okay. Yeah. I don't take it personally.
Yeah. You know how many blue Subarus there are out there?
It's not a blue one anymore.
Oh, gray, it's silverish.
It's a red one now.
Oh, it's red?
And I park it end to end with another red one that's identical to it because you can't tell. Subaru doesn't change their body type.
No.
So you can't tell a new one from an old one. Oh, well,
Thank God I know that the last two letters of my license plate are WA.
Because you can find it?
So I can find it. Because I know my car is gray, and it has a license plate that has WA on it. That's all I know. That's all I know.
They all kind of look the same, don't they?
Yeah. No.
And now it's time for therapy with Bob Plass.
I'm so damn tired, Kath. I've been up for 4 hours, and I no, it's 3 hours, 4 hours, four hours.
I can't get the door.
I need a nap.
Bob, listen, I got to go pick up my cat, so you're on your
get the damn door. Get the door before you
come.
Let's
get
this over with.
On my way out, and then I'm leaving.
I got to get home.
All right. Okay.
He's got 7 minutes. That's it. 7 minutes.
7 minutes. Now, are you going to still charge him $50 for 7 minutes?
Of course I am.
Wasn't that a movie, 7 minutes? No, 9 minutes.
No, 9 minutes.
All right.
That's another whole thing.
All right. Good morning, Ken.
Was it 9 or 7 minutes in heaven?
I don't know.
7 minutes in heaven.
Okay.
Come right in. Bob is waiting for you.
Speaking of heaven. Hello there, Kenny.
Hello there, Robert.
Come right in. Sit down.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much. Kenny is in the house. What can I do for you, my friend?
The weather's pissing me off.
I kind of knew that because, if it's not sunny, Kenny is not happy.
Well, it's not that.
What is it?
It hasn't been warm enough because I have a pool I want to open, and I just can't get into opening the pool when I wake up and it's 40 degrees.
Is your pool out there with water in it now?
It will be this weekend, one way or the other.
Wait a minute. I've got it. I thought July 4th was the opening of most
Memorial Day.
Memorial Day. It's
cool. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Does the heat of the pool require, or does the chloroform or whatever you put in there to keep bugs away?
If I had a pool full of chloroform, I wouldn't be here right now, Bob.
What is it? What do you put? What do you put in?
Trunk.
Whatever you put in it.
Trichlor.
What is it called?
Trichlor.
Trichlor. Is that dependent on weather?
I think you were thinking of chlorine.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah.
Chlorine.
Yeah.
When I know what Bob is thinking, chlorine. It's scary.
Yeah, and I use the trichlor version of that.
I see. So does it matter that the weather is bad for?
No. Matter of fact, the hotter it gets, it tends to grow the algae quicker. But you keep your chlorine around 4, and you don't really have much of a problem. And I got the solar cover to heat.
Well, why are you complaining then? If the solar
I can't get in the mood. I can't get in the mood.
You can't get in the mood. Once you get in your shorts and you're out there in the pool, floating around, you know, you're going to feel happy. What I would suggest to you is do one of those things like you do in the ocean. You just take the bull by the horns, get into your bathing suit, jump in, be covered in that water, then you're going to be forced into that, and there's going to be some
I have
joy.
To open the pool first.
But see, the word open to me means like a door.
No, I have
or
to.
Or you're charging admission.
I have to top the water.
Are you charging admission this year?
I have to top the water off. I have to treat it. I have to bring the temp up and...
Sounds like an awful lot of work.
It is.
It is.
And I can't get into it. Plus, I don't really have much time to do it because Cole's in there is overworking me the next 2 weeks.
It's all your fault then, Peter.
Peter.
We have stuff going on.
Yeah, we
and
do.
And you're getting paid.
Yeah, we have stuff going on. So
there's just a few things going on around here.
And Pete knows that everything that we need to get done trumps my pool. We've already had that conversation.
Mm-hmm. So we can expect you in the pool when? So we can
not for a while.
It's going to be a July 4th holiday, probably.
No,
maybe
a couple of weeks.
June.
Yeah.
June.
I don't think it's really hot enough right now to really warm it up to make it worthwhile going into.
Well,
the sun hasn't been out long enough.
No,
you know,
why can't you buy a an aquarium heater and heat? Is that going to be enough to heat up something?
Oh, hell no.
No.
What about one of those little coffee things that you make coffee in? You stick the little thing in.
Yeah, I'm going to get in my pool with one of those electrodes.
Yeah.
I don't know. Listen, why don't you fill the pool with fish? And take up fishing. That's it. Then you don't have to get. Just put the fish in the pool. Put some koi in there and go koi fishing.
Can't
that's my solution.
Fishing.
That'll be $50.
Fishing.
Yeah. That'll be $50. Leave it with your receptionist who's known around these parts as Kathy. Kath, will you take the money from him?
Bob,
then we're running.
You know, you always make me do this, and he never wants to pay, and we always run into this, and then you make me do it. I don't want to do this anymore, Bob. Yeah. I don't want to do this anymore. Why am I doing that?
I don't know.
Oh, Bob.
Bob?
You know, Robert, you reacted when I played my own personalized bump that you never
heard. I loved it. I love it.
You know, I actually have another tune.
You do?
It's the Ken Stomsky Blues.
The Ken Stomsky Blues.
Yes.
This is a good one.
Yes.
Woke up this morning.
Well, you know what? I've got it queued up here, Pete. Why don't we do the blues, and then you can just jump in with the top of the hour.
Who you got in the second hour today, Kenny?
Me and Kathy. It's me and you, kid.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, last week, you know, Rick said, okay, let's talk about beer this week. But, you know, middle of the weekend, he's like, you know, I couldn't get anyone. And I didn't feel like rushing around to try to find anyone to come in. But I'm bringing back something that we used to do up at the university.
Okay.
All right.
Sounds good to me.
So.
You mean Bob and I are going to let you talk?
I'm going. He can talk all he wants.
So
you're on your own.
So for Bob, we're gonna play Ken Stomsky Blues.
I love it.
And then we'll play the usual top of the hour.
I got the Ken Stomsky Blues.
The what?
It's Tuesday morning. Ken
Stomsky.
Stomsky Blues.
What?
I can't pronounce my name.
Weekly program with his sidekick, Kathy Palmer. We call her Den Mother. Discussions of local events and happenings here on Studio Session 120. Kenny Stomsky, local weekly program for you.
I love it.
Talking about the
newfangled
Ken Stomsky Blues.
It's newfangled.
Newfangled.
I roll up to the studio. Who do I see? My buddy, my stop. Oh, look, it's Harry Ross.
It's everywhere. Don't touch it, we just talk.
I got the cash, Tom's keep loose. I'm singing for you. With a dead mother, too.
Nothing like a kazoo.
Underwriting for Community Radio on WSKB is brought to you in part by Rockies. Over 30 convenient locations throughout Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, Connecticut, and Florida. One of the nation's largest Ace dealers. Expertise and great product selection in paint, hardware, lawn and garden. That's Rockies. Rock solid service since 1926. On the web at Rockies.com.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow, It's Tuesday, every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow, It's Tuesday.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM, WSKB, Westfield.
Prison pen pals?
Yes, a lot of people write prisoners. Even Hollywood celebrity Cal Penn.
Here
Cal
we go.
Penn writes a prisoner? Yeah, Ken lives in California. You've never heard of Cal Penn's Pen Pal Ken in the Cal Pen? How could I possibly have heard of Cal Penn's Pen Pal Ken in the Cal Pen? Through this song?
Well, I do get a yen every now and then to pick up a pen like my pal Cal Penn, and a note I will send every now and again to my pal Big Ben, who is locked in the pen because he beat up some men and he got 5 to 10, and he'll do it again. Da-da-da-da-da, Cal Penn.
What? Who is that for? What are you talking about? Phil Spector's in this prison.
Kid, I know talent and shooting waitresses in the mouth, and you've got talent. We're going to make a record.
Oh, Ken.
Oh, my God. Who the hell cares?
There you go.
By the way, we have a news update from Michael Buster McMahon.
All righty. What is this news update?
Instant karma got me this morning at the blackjack table. Uh-huh. Me having a 14 versus a dealer's 10. I think I'll stay. Dealer, what? You never play a hand wrong. Mm. Me, whisper, you accidentally show me your whole card. You have a 4, and I'm going to stay. Dealer flips over his whole card and then, of course, pulls a 7. Me, I probably got what I deserved there, didn't I? Dealer, think you did.
Mm. He was leaving auditions last night to go to work.
I was expecting a bullet to come up in the hand.
No.
Yeah. A bullet, an eighth. You never heard that one?
No,
Michael goes to his job, and then he goes to his part-time job.
I know he does.
Yeah. When he gets out of work, he goes to his part-time job, makes what he needs to make for the day. Yeah. Well, he used to work 3 jobs.
Hmm.
Yeah, you got a.
He used to do the radio show over at WMAS in the afternoon.
Mm-hmm. Yep. A.M.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, what's up?
HLL, sorry.
You have the bullet, you have the deuce. You know what clubs are called?
No.
Puppy feet.
Ooh, okay.
You used
I
to
see
do
that.
Talk about when you're playing a pitch.
Okay. I'm not a card player, and I'm not a casino. I have never been
I used to
MGM.
Be a crack canasta player, but I've completely forgotten how to do that. It used to be one of the things I did with my aunt who passed away.
I used to
And my
do,
grandfather.
I used to do pitch leagues.
We played pitch around the camp. Yeah, around the campsite.
That and cribbage. I got involved with that.
Never cribbage. In a cribbage.
Yeah. I love cribbage.
Cribbage. Wow.
Yeah, when you give the skunk to someone, oh yeah, that feels so good.
Okay then.
Yeah.
I don't know anything about cards, mm-hmm. other than Old Maid and Go Fish. That was it when I was a kid. Done.
Canasta was a hard game, as I recall. Yeah.
You know, one game I don't know how to play, and one of these days I just want to learn is bridge.
Bridge.
Never.
I just want to know how it's done.
Hmm. We're looking for someone to actually teach bridge.
Mm-hmm.
We used to have someone down at the women's club that gave lessons, but she has since retired from it. So we've been looking for someone that mm-hmm. knows how to
you
teach.
You should
it.
Ask Tina.
Tina Gorman?
Yeah.
She's probably busy, though. They do it on.
Ask her if she knows anybody that would. Somebody that comes in the senior center might be a bridge player.
I don't know. I'm sure they know people there.
I think there were some people on the 350 committee who played bridge.
And they probably do play bridge already. There's quite a group. They play in a couple different places. They play in Southwick.
Mm-hmm.
And then they play in the women's club. Do they play at the senior center? They must.
I don't know.
Huh. I don't either. But it's not a game that ever attracted me.
It doesn't attract me. I just want to...
No,
when I read about it in the paper,
yeah.
I want to know what the hell's going on.
Gotcha. I know. I see that.
It's not a normal deck of cards. It's completely different.
Okay. Okay. You've got mail.
You've got mail.
Yeah, that's how old I am.
You're still on AOL?
That email address is over 25 years old.
Wow.
Why get rid of it? It's like my phone number. I've had that for 25 years.
Okay. All right. Speaking of phone number, I had 3 phones at home on the regular line. 2 of them have now died. When the third one goes, that's it for my regular landline. It's going. Mm-hmm. Do you have a landline?
Yeah.
No. You do?
Yeah.
Why do you have the landline? I'm just curious.
Because I was able to get in before all the plans changed, and it's a I forget what kind of account it's called. It's like $10 a month just to have it, but
I wish.
You pay for everything incoming and outgoing.
All I get is robocalls. I don't get them from Uncle Bill anymore. Remember Uncle Bill in Florida?
Florida.
Yeah, I don't. Maybe Uncle Bill died. Yeah. Then they didn't tell me. Mm-hmm. Oh dear heavens! Speaking of crank calls,
limited is that what the service is called? Mm. I don't know.
Maybe I should call them because my bill is $80 a month, and all I get is robocalls. So maybe I should call them and say I'm done with you if I don't get a cheaper rate.
There you go.
Maybe they'll change because I don't care if I'm done with
them. Or they'll say no and because they want to get rid of copper anyway. So,
well, you know, Peter, nobody calls me. I have one friend that calls me on the landline, and I tell her she's my $79 friend.
Yeah, you got to get rid of that expense.
Yeah, $79 is way too much for that. You should it's be able ridiculous. To get a limited access something. You should call them to see what packages you can take.
Well, I'll try.
I think it's like a local only. You can only dial within the 413
or something. I only have local only because I got rid of AT&T a long time ago. I don't have a long-distance carrier.
And it's
why would I do that? I have my cell phone.
They may have a special plan for older adults.
Seasoned citizens.
I heard that. Do you mean moi? Speaking of older adults, my birthday's next week, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be older than I am today.
That's usually how it works.
That is how it works.
But you're still a couple of weeks older than the other Palmer.
Younger. I'm younger.
You're still young. Yeah, younger.
Well, I think I've given up with that. We're pretty much the same. I can go with pretty much the same now. Mm-hmm. So
I'm sure she prefers that more than you.
No, we don't care, honestly. We're pretty proud that we got this far, that we're still going and we're still okay. So I don't mind it at all.
Yeah, you're still active and she's still out there teaching exercise.
Oh, my goodness gracious, yes, yes. Well, I was at a wake and I hadn't seen the wife in a very, very long time. And she said, and you're who? And I said, who I was. And she said, oh, yes, that's right. You do all those things at the Y.
Mm-hmm.
And I just said, yep, because right. There's no point in even.
No.
Except the other Palmer has the red hair. But we go way back.
Mm-hmm.
Our Palmer is from William the Nailer Palmer, who came in on the Fortune.
Hey, Pete, sounds like a good wrestling name.
The Nailer, doesn't it? William
the Nailer.
The Nailer, because he made nails. He came in on the Fortune, which was the second ship to come into Plymouth Harbor in 16. He came in 1621, November, mm-hmm. on the Fortune. And he lived in Plymouth. And then somehow they ended up in Hopkinton. Then they ended up in Beckett. In fact, they lived on the farm that's now Jacob's Pillow. That's where mm-hmm. the Palmers lived. And then they moved to Westfield. So there.
Well, wait a minute. I thought there was no relationship between the two Palmers here.
No, there isn't any relationship between me and Carol.
No.
No, this is my Palmer.
Your family. Palmer. Okay.
Yeah, my Palmer family was an original Plymouth family.
Mm-hmm.
And we can trace it directly. Someone had done it. Now, I didn't do the work. I wouldn't know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm the dirty Irish that came over in the 1850s.
Right.
So, you know, the usurpers. Those dirty Irish that we don't want in any of the stores. Yeah. Yeah. That would be me.
Mm-hmm.
They almost burned down St. Mary's Church.
Wow.
They did. Shocking. Shocking.
What we can't drink on Sunday?
Shocking. Yeah. And you know, that's... Here's your history lesson of Westfield. If you remember growing up, and I know you're going to remember this, the North Side was always thought of as what? What was our reputation on the North Side?
You were the brawlers.
We were the brawlers.
Yeah.
And even when I was I lived on the South Side. Mm-hmm. So when I got to it was then the intermediate school, not the one today, but the one back then. And when I got there, I was a little bit afraid of the North Side mm-hmm. kids,
because
I thought they were going to beat me up.
Yeah, well, we'd had rumbles in the playground.
But listen, there is some historic basis for that. When the canal was coming through and the railroads were coming through, they needed hard labor to build those canals and the railroad. And the only people who were available to take those jobs were some of the immigrants coming in. That's when you were getting the famines in Ireland. And so they came here, and it was the men who came in, unmarried men, and they would stay in the hotels on the north side.
Okay.
Because that was close to where they were working.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of, if you look at the houses on the lower hill, there's a lot of tenement buildings. Those were built as housing for the workers. And then you had the Bismarck Hotel there. You had several hotels. And guess what would happen? They would get their paycheck.
Mm-hmm.
They had to cash their paycheck. They'd go to the bar to cash their paycheck. Ta-da!
Oh, he doesn't smell like Irish Spring, and he never taught me anything. But still, I slap my chest and sing of my drunken Irish dad. Oh, his face looks like a railroad map, and he never shuts his friggin' trap. But all the ladies catch the clap from your drunken Irish dad. Ask a Hennessy, Tennessee, Morrison, Shaughnessy, Reardon, and Rooney, they'll tell you the same. McNulty, Mulrooney, and Cotter, and Clooney all feel the same mixture of pride and of shame. Finnegan, Hannigan, Kelly, and Flanagan look to the ground when their dad passes by. Cafferty, Rafferty, Joyce, and O'Lafferty fight for his honor and then start to cry. Lads are all infirm and our moods infect us like a germ, cause we're all the spawn of a pickled sperm, and we don't tan well either.
Pretty much how it went back then.
Yes, it did.
Yeah.
Yes, it did.
Come on, man.
Then all of a sudden it got really popular to be Irish. How did that happen? I don't know how that happened, cause now we have some of the biggest parades in the country.
We're
here.
The party people.
Ah, there you go, the party people.
Yeah. I never really looked into my mother's side, which is Scottish, Irish, Finnish.
Scotch, Irish, yep.
Yeah, and I know that it had to happen probably around the same time. I'm not really sure when they came over. I never really looked because it's a very common, she had a very common name, McKay.
Ah.
So that's tough to figure out the lineage. Okay. I think that might be why I haven't really looked into it. But on the my father's side, you know, I can trace to where we came. My great grandmother came in through Ellis Island, I've been able to find that online, which is kind of cool. So I don't go. I think even on my mother's side, I don't go back as far as you may.
It's hard to go back.
She was born and grew up in Winthrop, which is, you know. Not all that far away from there, but
a lot of them too, Ken, came down from Canada.
Eh?
They land. Oh, that was bad. They landed in Canada, so the records are not in English, and it's hard to go back and trace some of them because when they came down.
So you're telling me no one speaks French anymore?
Well, I don't. I mean, high school French, but I don't. So who the heck knows? I don't know where we came from. I know we came. I know I had family that came from County Mayo, Ireland, and that's all I really know.
Uh-huh.
So I'm mostly Irish, a little bit of French. Then there's a teeny tiny little teeny bit of Scandinavian, something like that. Just a little.
It's funny because you don't look Irish.
I'm Black Irish. And what they call the Black Irish.
Oh, okay. Explain, Lucy.
The Black Irish are those with the black hair as opposed to the red hair. Uh-huh. Everybody thinks the Irish has red hair, but they don't.
Mm-hmm.
We were Black Irish, and my brother was the Black Irish with the blue eyes.
Uh-huh.
So, but I'm mostly Irish.
Mm-hmm.
Although then my maiden name was Hibbert, which is French. They pronounce it Hébert. I have family down in New Orleans. They never say Hibbert.
Uh-huh.
It's always Hébert.
Uh-huh.
So that's an not Hebert. It's Hibert.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, I'm related to the teachers, but they're cousins. They're distant cousins. And their family came from Peru, Mass. And they came down from Canada. Peter, where's yours from?
My family?
Yeah.
The sword side?
I forget you're a sword.
Yes,
why do I forget
I'm swords,
that?
Yeah. My Irish all comes from the sword side of the family. The Cole side of the family are German. And we believe we're related to the Coles in Amherst and the Coles in Westfield. But because a German Protestant married an Irish Catholic, I don't know a lot of the Cole side of the family.
Interesting. I didn't realize
they all disowned my grandfather.
That was Germanic in origin. I didn't know that's what Cole's was. I always thought it was English.
Nope.
Why did I think that?
Nope.
Huh.
Guten Tag.
Guten Tag.
Yeah, there's that.
Guten Tag.
Yeah, I was going through some footage the past 3 weeks, and one of the students, I put a body cam on them, so now they're going on all the rides, and one of the rides, it didn't look very like it was much of anything from outside.
Rides where?
Busch Gardens.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, when you were down there with the chorus.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and so I put a body cam on one of them,
oh, geez.
Which he wore willingly, and he loved having it on.
I would be the screamer.
Yeah, so there's this one ride, and you just see, you know, where the cars go on a rail around the corner and disappear. And then they come back around the corner discreetly, and that's it. Okay, well, this might be just a little snoozer, you know, a calm little ride. And I'm watching, I watched the video the other night, and there are screen. It goes around the corner, and it immediately starts to descend and corkscrew, and you're inside a house the entire time. It was black.
Oh,
and they are screaming and going nuts.
Oh, jeez.
And they, you know, they're pulling up to the end of the ride, and like, that was the best one. That was, and this was a ride where they shut it down for 20 minutes because they had to get rid of one of the cars or something. It was defective. And they were determined. They were already in line, and a lot of people got out of line. But out of all the rides, it was the best ride that they rode. And you can't tell anything by looking at the darn thing. And I'm watching the video, and there's like lightning and flames and fire and things like that going on inside the building.
Fire.
and the name of the ride, which is why I'm trying to get there really hard, but the name of the ride was Verboten.
Verboten.
Verboten. Okay. That makes sense.
So none of them spoke English. or German.
German.
Yeah.
So they didn't know what it was.
But I was getting faxes sent to me in error from Germany. And I'm like, you know, I got to spend $2 to send the fax. It was going on for a month or two, like twice a week. So I decided to spend a few bucks on the phone call back with the fax machine. And I had to learn how to, you know, write specifically what I'm trying to get across. And one of them was Verboten. And so I look at that. They go, I go, you know what that means? They go, no. I go, forbidden.
Forbidden. Do not enter. Forbidden.
Yeah. So
That's funny.
Yeah, that's...
Are you a big one on rides? Do you like the rides in the amusement park?
Yeah, I'll go on them, but when you're playing cameraman and chaperone, you just kind of, you know, stand back. You let the youngins have fun.
The youngins.
Yeah, I myself and one other chaperone went on one ride.
What did you go on?
Bumper cars.
Those are
which
fun.
Were right next to Verboten. and
they bring out the child.
And I told, you know, I told, you know, two of the kids decided not to go on. I'm like, here, just hold this stuff. Well, whilst
Peter.
You
know,
and I'm looking at my footage back. They figured out that they could operate this equipment. And that they were going to operate the equipment. So now they
got some really good candid stuff then.
So they filmed us waiting, the chaperones waiting in line. They showed us in the bumper cars. Yeah.
That's good. Good job, kids.
Yeah.
Great job.
Yeah. They turn around. They're filming each other. You know, they're like giving me a little Easter egg to use.
Yeah, candids. That's always awesome.
Yes, they are.
Well, that's why. And you know what? I knew we weren't going to have a guest this hour. I originally had this thing in my mind And this came to my mind actually a couple of months ago, but it's also inspired from making the list last week. Which, by the way, did Barry Zepp bring the belt back?
I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, I don't see it.
You need to email him.
All right. Where have I gone?
So
up at the college from time to time, mm-hmm. when I just didn't have a guest, I didn't feel like talking. We played this little thing, comparing the cover to the original.
Okay.
And we'd play each and then just talk about it. You know, it was fun. I haven't done that since up at the university.
Okay.
And a few months ago, I actually put it on one of my notes. I put it in quadrant three because I have quadrant one, two, three, and four for a to-do. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, you know, cover show, cover song show. Something I want to do maybe every other month or whatever just to break things up a bit. And I had that all set up today. But I forgot how easy it is to lose all control and track of time when you're in here.
Well, that does happen. Oh, look, squirrels, shiny things, yeah. Cupcakes. Yeah.
So I haven't said that. You know, I know I gave this to Pete and my legal paper, my on-air paper. I do have the USB card here okay. with all the songs lined up. Maybe I'll do one of them. Maybe I'll okay. do two. But you know, we were talking about that documentary I'm working on. And earlier, the first hour, you know, I got frustrated, and then I found out, a little trick to use. And you know, just a couple of minutes ago, we talked about the body cam. Mm-hmm. So I went down with 8 cameras.
Wow. Holy smokes!
Yeah, oh yeah. and you know, several of them are 2 full HD. I think one's a 4K. That you just, it's handheld. You open it up. You have the screen and whatnot. And I had some selfie sticks with me. Okay. So there was this one girl. Her name was Campbell. She actually goes by the nickname Soup. Yeah.
That's cute.
Yeah.
That's
very cute. So she's now walking around with her cell phone with, you know, her headset attached to it, trying to interview people. So I'm like, okay, all right, I'm going to put her to work, right? So I take one of the handheld cams. I put a selfie stick down on the bottom of it. They go, here, why don't you use this one instead? She, over the period of the trip, she shot 10 gigabytes worth of video.
Good for her.
You know, she had it running for hours on the bus. She had it running all during mini golf. And you know, now and then she'd shoot herself, and now and then she'd be interviewing other people. So I got a lot of candid stuff there too.
Now,
and anything that she shoots, it's called the Soup Cam. Get it?
The Soup Cam.
Are you going to put a graphic on there?
Oh yeah. I've already done it once, and
you just
up in the left hand side.
You
I have
to drag it over to your drag that piece into your storage bin, so you don't have to cut and paste every time.
I've only done it once, so I'm sure I'm going to get to that point.
I'll show you how to do it with I do that for In the Zone.
Yeah. So I come up with, you know, a name, Soup Cam. I have REC in brackets in red over on the other side. So, it looks like, you know, what you see on TV and movies.
Now, what are you going to do with these videos? Are they going to go on Channel 15? Are you going to give them to the kids, to Corey?
Once it's all together, we're going to have a reveal party.
All of the above.
And then, yeah, it's going to go on 15. I think Pete is going to try to put it into distribution somewhere.
Yeah, it'll go up on the YouTube channel.
Yeah, YouTube, but I think through the Connect, I think you have a bigger reach than I do with that. Nobody.
Oh, yeah, to syndicate it. Yeah,
to syndicate it, because nobody looks at Southwick for syndicating anything.
They've been pulling a lot of stuff off mine.
Yeah, so I want to put it in the syndication there. I want to see how far it'll get, because it this isn't me patting myself on my shoulder, but I've got hours and hours and hours into it, and it's one of the more complex, involved documentaries I've ever edited, and I'm doing my best at it, and I think it's going to be really good.
Send it down to the theme park.
Yeah.
You never know what they'll use.
Yeah. There was a point in time when we were at Pirate's Cove Mini Golf, and they broke into a performance. And
they tend to do that.
And the oh yeah, everywhere we went, they broke into something, and I have it all on film.
Yeah.
So the owner of the mini golf, they filmed them and they used them with their social media and whatnot. So yeah, I'm gonna have to figure out what tags that a lot of them are using right now, and just make sure I add them and see how far it goes.
That's a lot of work, though. That's a lot of work. How many hours do you think you put in just to doing the editing and putting it together?
Ballpark 4, 8, figure. 12, 16, 20, 20, 40. I'm at 60 hours right now.
That's a lot
of people
time.
Think it's easy.
Yeah.
Oh, I know, Peter. Yeah. I write plays. It takes me, just doing the research alone, takes me forever and ever. Honestly, once I sit down to do it, it's only a couple days, but it's all the pre-work, like with your cutting, and that's what I do.
Yeah,
it's with plays.
Yeah, I have to index each and every video file.
The planning, what am I doing, where am I going, what's my vision, what do I want?
And then you get something done, and then you find something else. I need to figure out how to get...
Yes, you do.
Yep.
And it finally comes to a point where you say, okay, that's it, I'm done, I'm not going to touch it again, because if you go back, you will. You know you will.
Yeah, I'll be going back.
Giving you the finger.
I'll be going back. But, you know, there could be certain segments where if you really want to get fancy and you're doing something you don't already have a template built for, it could take you 3, 4, 5 hours to do 2 minutes worth of film.
I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I have some things right now where I have 30 seconds of footage that has 9 or 10 layers on it.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure you do. Absolutely.
And when we're talking about layers, Pete understands what I'm talking about. But every time you add something to a scene, it's a layer.
No, I know.
So
we use the same term.
Well, people, you know,
we use the term layering in theater. We start very basic, and then we add this, and then we add that. We add this. You add costumes. You add set. You add pieces. You
exactly.
You know, so, yeah, we use the word.
And then you expand it, and then you have to get everything to line up, and then all of a sudden, oh, for some reason, the audio is out of sync. And then you find out, okay, you're off by 1/64th of an inch on one of your, it's crazy.
Back you go. Let's change it and fix it. Oh, wait, I don't like that there. Why did I do it that way? Yeah. Oh, I've got to fix that. Oh, wait a minute, I've got a better idea. It goes on and on.
Yeah.
On and on.
Yeah.
Stop.
I am, if I say halfway, I'm going to sound ambitious, but I'm just about halfway through the edit.
Okay.
So I think by the time I'm done, it might be a 100-hour edit job.
Oh, jeepers. Well, that's not unusual with these projects.
Oh, no. With something this intense or this size? No, not really.
Yeah.
You know, it makes me think now that a half-hour episode on television, how long that must be in post-production.
Right. That's the whole point. Yeah. Like Deadliest Catch, they go shoot it over the winter, and it doesn't come out till like now. Yeah. And they're still editing. This is when they get the first shows done. And then they're continuing to edit all through the season to make sure they're like maybe one or two shows ahead. Mm. But they're constantly editing. And that's the same thing that you went through. They go out and shoot all these footage and all these boats. Then they have to log it all and be able to tell the story. And that's how they come up with their episodes. It's a lot of work.
It is. And in this particular case, what I'm doing, it's a work of passion. Because I am friends of the DeGray Bruno family. Our parents, her dad, my father, both went to school at trade. So my father was 62, he was 64. That's kind of how the families go back a little bit. But I knew her old man for quite some time. And then, you know, Jay got involved with choir, and then we started recording it. And it just started building up and building up and building up. And it reminds me of how I, you know, when I was a kid, you know, I didn't come from a musical family, as I was talking about. You know, I tried keyboards. My parents tried to shove the cello down me because that's what they offered in school, the strings in school. And no music talent at all in my family. So at that time, there wasn't much in the schools really outside of, you know, the half hour music class that you got, you know, once a week or whatever. So I see what these kids are pulling off. Not only the choir, but band as well, because I record all the band stuff now for Patrick Kennedy. And the reason why I'm just going so out on this video or this document, well, there's two reasons. One, they kicked ass last year. Now, the whole idea of this documentary is, all right, they kicked ass last year. What are they going to do this year? And I don't reveal what happens until the very end of the film, obviously.
Yeah, so we all know.
We all know.
We all know.
But in syndication, people don't know. So you know, it builds up. But I, putting something really professional and nice together, I think the kids deserve it. Plain and simple of it. I think they deserve it. Don't tell anyone I'm a nice guy.
Shh, we won't spread that rumor.
No.
Trust me, we won't spread that
rumor. Oh, no. I want people to continue to think I'm a real total bastard. I mean, I just...
No, you don't. You silly boy.
Curmudgeon.
Curmudgeon. I just said that last night. Somebody asked me if I was auditioning, and I said no. The only roles I ever get are crabby old ladies.
Mm-hmm.
Such a surprise.
Yeah.
Such a surprise.
You know, I could see Salty in there, too.
Yes, that's sarcastic.
I think you could be Salty.
Sarcastic.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That'd be true. Uh-huh. I'd be very good at that.
Yeah. For ladies. Oh, and I'm going to use the word ladies. I don't care what they say in East Hampton. I'm going to say ladies.
Can somebody explain why that's objectionable? Please. I don't understand that.
Because maybe one of them wasn't identifying as lady at that point.
I don't.
Who knows?
So we can't say ladies and gentlemen?
Well,
confused.
Perhaps not, because there's a recall going on up there now for the school board.
I know. And I'm thrilled.
Yeah, that is.
I am.
That's awesome.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Yeah. So for ladies, is it sarcastic and not salty? Is that, you know?
I'm okay with whatever. There are a few names I don't want you to call me, but those are okay. There's a few.
What about the ones I say in your basement?
Shh. Ken, we're going to keep that quiet.
Oh, I forgot.
Yeah, and don't mention the police log.
Mm-hmm.
Shh. Which is back in the
paper. And
again.
I'm so happy they're using anonymous names now. They're just making up names, so no one will ever know it's us.
They will never know. They will never know.
They'll never be able to figure it out. It's been brought back into detail, like Carl Hartigan used to write them 15 years ago.
Oh, yeah, he was funny. He was pretty funny. But I sit there and I find myself reading the police log. It's like I read the real estate listings. Why?
Mm-hmm.
Do I really care that somebody complained that their dog barked? I mean, I really don't, but mm-hmm. I find myself getting sucked into it. It's sort of like it's like social media in the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
I want to read about someone complaining, and I love it. Some of the calls I think are hilarious. Mm-hmm. You know, loud music coming from their neighbor's yard.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's 6 in the afternoon. What would you like us mm-hmm. to do? It's just people chill. I'd like to say to them, chill.
Well then there's some sagas that you can see going on too, like down at a paper mill where there's always
sagas going on there.
Yeah, one person always mad at all of their neighbors and.
They put
like
something in my yard. Pick it up.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. It is pretty funny.
Yeah, a dog pooped on the sidewalk 5 blocks away from me.
God, I have that trouble. I want my neighbor to pick up his. Oh no, wait a minute. That was the cows. Never mind.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
I know they should.
You just can't carry
it.
You just can't carry a little plastic baggie to pick.
No,
that up.
No. Can't do that. I stepped in it many times.
Mm-hmm.
Which reminds me, did you see what I did this morning? Holy moly, I'm embarrassed.
Did you get a cat?
I forgot to change my shoes. I can't believe I went out in public with these shoes.
I can't believe you own a pair of those.
I know. I know. They're my house shoes. And because I was busy with that stupid cat, fixed him, didn't I?
you really did fix him.
Oh,
huh?
I did fix him.
All right.
I'm going up the hill carrying this 20-pound cat, and I looked down and went, oh, rats. I have these terrible, old, ugly shoes.
They're not just terrible, old, ugly
shoes.
They're awful.
They're awful.
They're
awful.
They're
That's wonderful radio you guys got going on there.
It's going to get better. It's not just old, ugly shoes.
Go ahead. Go for it.
They're Crocs.
I know. They're Crocs. And I can't believe
it. Howie Crocs?
And these are original Crocs. These are the real Crocs. These aren't the ones you find in some other stores. These are the real Crocs that I have on my feet. And I went out the door and then Peter, and I never go out the door wearing anything like this on my feet. Oh, well.
Okay.
So at least they're not my garden. Well, or they're not my barn boots.
At least you're not wearing pajamas at Wally.
I know. But, that's really interesting. The things that people go out of the house in.
I've seen people shopping at Wally in onesies.
Oh, dear Lord in heaven. No, I can't do that. No, I can't do that. You know, back in the...
You'd look cute in a onesie. I'm trying to picture myself in one, but that wouldn't work. But you would look cute.
I'm too short to wear a lot of things. Honestly, I'm way too short.
Negative, Ghost Rider. The pattern is full.
What?
Peter's trying to be funny.
I didn't hear it.
I did.
I missed it. What did you say?
I was replying to Ken.
Okay. I think you need to be tall to wear. Well, you need to be tall to wear a lot of things. The third graders used to say, Mrs. Palmer, I'm as tall as you are. And I said, everybody's as tall as I am. I try not to teach anything anything taller.
You get to save money by shopping in the children's department.
You know what? I do. Uh-huh. I buy children's shoes, not the Crocs. Uh-huh. But I go into the department. I had to buy waterproof sneakers on Amazon. It's the only place I could find them. Because I'm going away. I'm going to Alaska. Mm-hmm. And a friend of mine was there, and she said, you really need to have waterproof shoes. Well, I don't have any waterproof shoes. Do you have waterproof shoes?
Yeah, I have ocean shoes, yeah.
Peter, do you have waterproof shoes?
Not waterproof, but I have pool and ocean shoes.
Yeah, but you need hiking waterproof.
Oh, that type of
stuff. Yeah.
And neither of us hike, so we don't have that type of thing.
The only place I hike is Toccoa. Mm-hmm. I do hike Toccoa, which is a fabulous place to go. Mm-hmm. But you got to do some walking. You got to get up the mountain and back down the mountain. And I go with Harry. So if you go with Harry, you go at double time speed. Double time. We're on our march. Off we go.
Harry is a force of nature.
Isn't he? I was a little nervous, Peter, in your office last week because I was standing in between Harry Rock and Bob Pless.
Oh, no.
So I thought, I have to get out of here quickly because one of them is going to have a suggestion of something I should be doing.
Right.
So I left very quickly. Harry just got back from Portugal.
Yeah.
I know.
You know, the problem with going hiking with Harry is because he does have long strides.
He does.
When that rattlesnake comes out to say boo, he can run a lot faster than you.
I know. You know, I've never...
It doesn't matter.
I've never seen one up there.
Yeah, it doesn't matter how fast you run. It's how much faster you
run. Than the other person.
Yeah.
They're very slow. Here's a fact that'll make you feel better for all you hikers out there. No one in Massachusetts has died of a rattlesnake bite since the 1700s. So, and the rattlesnake that we have, the timber rattlesnake.
Even if you get bit, I still don't want to get bit.
Yeah, it's not a good idea, and it will make you very, very ill. Very ill.
You'll have to go to the hospital for sure.
Yes, and there's not a lot of available venom either, Peter, because it's only good for so long.
Anti-venom.
And it's very anti-venom, and it doesn't last, so hospitals don't always stock it. So you have to get it first. But... it's not a very aggressive snake. In other words, unless you really step on it, it's probably.
Yeah, you got to piss it off.
Probably not going to bother.
And you know, one thing I have heard, if you happen to set one off and it starts rattling its tail, if you just grab the tail, it'll calm the snake and it'll go right to sleep.
I'm not going to test your
theory. I'm thinking...
I saw it on the internet, so it must be
true. Oh, well, then it is true. Well, if you saw it on the internet, that explains it. Mm-hmm. It's got to be true because everything is true on the internet.
Right. I'm not testing the theorem.
You're not going to test it? No, I'm not either. But we have, you know, we have the brown water snake here, Peter. The brown water snake is in a lot of the waterways, and they're nasty suckers. They look like, people think they're cottonmouths because they look very similar. But cottonmouths are not indigenous to this area. They don't live in Western Mass. They're a warm water snake, but they look like it. And they're very aggressive, and they're very mean. And if they bite you, you better get attention. They're not venomous, but their fangs are very long. And they really shove way in.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not nice. Stay away from them. We've had them in the brook. I have not seen one in Moose Meadow Brook in years. And someone mentioned that is because we have a lot of bald eagles now.
Mm-hmm.
And hawks. And they like snakes. So maybe they're eating all my snakes and I'm okay. But I didn't, you know what I didn't have? I didn't have those eels this year.
Why is Bob back?
Who knows?
He's parked like in the middle of the driveway.
Is this his mouse? There's a red mouse here. Is that Bob's?
Probably.
That's probably his mouse. See, he should have gotten a cat.
Go get your mouse, Bob.
I didn't notice it until now.
Bob parks in the middle of the driveway.
Did you come back for your $50?
My mouse is here. Bye.
Go out and volunteer.
Bye. My mouse is here. I wonder why they call it a mouse.
Well, originally they had a wire tied.
Look at where Bob parked.
You got to be kidding me.
No, I'm not.
All right, we're not talking about the black SUV backed up.
We'll watch Bob park, walk back to his car.
All right.
Well, we can narrate this. No, Bob parked in the middle of the...
In the very middle.
The complete very... Yeah, you can't get any more middle than that.
No. No, and there's plenty of available space.
And we can watch Bob depart.
Yeah. So, what's he going to... All right, so now he's actually going to pull into a space in order to...
And he's gonna do it.
Oh, he's gonna do
hey,
it.
It'll catch the accident.
Oh no! Another car is coming in.
Oh, jeepers!
That was almost an accident.
That
would have been great if we caught that on tape. Not good for Bob.
Oh, he's going so slow now after that.
I love when we have shows that are unstructured.
Oh, dear.
Otherwise known as dumpster fire.
Peter, if you tried to film that, you couldn't.
That would have been so funny if it got in an accident, even a fender bender.
I know. We were all going,
hey, Bob,
no, stop.
We would have walked out. We got it on video, Bob.
Oh.
That or if Miss B got out of the car with road rage on him or something
Miss
like
B,
that.
Yeah, Miss B wouldn't have been happy about that.
No, not a bit. Oh, dear Lord. Oh, Bob. Oh, Bob. We love you, Bob.
That just comes from Pete with his really fast reflexes and being able to pull that car up on the fly.
Oh, dear. All right. What else you got here, kid?
Nothing.
Look it.
Yeah, it doesn't make.
Hey, if you want to go two more minutes, I can play the jam song going out. Do you remember the jam song?
I remember the jam song.
It's about 6 minutes.
This is definitely not.
This would be a good day for that.
Radio. It'd be a good day.
It's all queued up.
I'll bear that in mind. So,
okay.
All right.
Yeah, we're not going to play the cover song game today.
Well,
we've run out of time.
Somehow this happens. I don't know how it happens.
Mm-hmm.
But we do manage to discuss some things that might be important.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure how important, but some things. Or we get to watch Bob come back in for his mouse.
God, that was funny.
Oh, my Lord in heaven. Please help us.
That was funny.
Please help us. It's a good thing you thought of switching the camera on, though, or we would have missed it.
And that, you know for a fact, we just saved him from an accident by switching on that camera, right?
Yeah, I think you're probably right.
Karma.
Pretty scary.
Right, exactly.
Pretty scary.
I love watching karma happen.
Karma. Do you believe in karma?
Oh, yeah.
Do you?
Yeah.
It does happen sometimes.
Yeah. And to be a fly on the wall when it happens, I mean, perfect.
Or it couldn't just happen. How many times do you think it
couldn't happen to a nicer person?
Yep, couldn't have happened to a nicer person. That, you took the words right out of my brain.
Absolutely. I'm all over that.
It's true. And then you feel guilty.
That is usually follows. Where was I going to go with this one? Couldn't happen to a nicer guy. Okay, that usually follows. No good deeds go unpunished.
Goes unpunished. I never quite understand that. I never.
That quite happens to me a lot. It. No good deeds go unpunished.
You do something good and then something bad happens.
Yeah.
Huh. I haven't seen that. I don't do good deeds. So there. Mm-hmm. Don't do a good deed and it won't happen. Mm-hmm. You can just never have bad things happen to you.
Too late. The new computer is scheduled to arrive this afternoon.
All right, that explains a lot.
Yeah.
My waterproof shoes are coming today. So good. I can't believe I had to buy sneakers. I never wear sneakers.
That's right. You usually come walk prancing in here with the boots or something.
I do. I wear. Well, I like that extra inch. Mm-hmm. It really works when you're 5'1".
Uh-huh.
And a half.
Right.
It's like when the little kids say I'm 8 and a half, mm-hmm. I say I'm 5'1 and a half, just to make me a little bit taller.
I had a girlfriend who was 4'11 before.
Oh, my Lord.
My gosh.
That's tiny.
Yeah.
4'11.
And I was about 50 pounds heavier then, too.
Oh, dear.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Yeah, we didn't really take many pictures.
My daughter is tall. Both my daughters are tall. My second daughter is quite tall. I don't know where that comes from because...
Not you.
No, and the Palmers aren't all that tall, although I understand the grandmother was tall, but mm-hmm. who knows? Genetics is a really strange thing mm-hmm. that you can have your brother or your sister and you have totally different DNA mm-hmm. that shows like... We were talking before about being Irish or Polish or Italian. You could have different amounts of that as a sibling,
mm-hmm.
not even be the same.
What about, and I've stopped being amazed by this, but you have two people relatively high IQs, you know, doctor, lawyer, couple, whatever. Their offspring is adult.
I know. Yep, that happens. And the opposite happens. You can have people that maybe are not higher up in the intelligence hierarchy, mm-hmm. and they end up with a child that's a genius.
Yeah.
But we don't really know where genius comes from anyway. We mm-hmm. don't understand that. We really don't understand it. We don't understand the brain in general. Mm-hmm. The idea that I just heard, and it was on the internet, so it must be true. It's got to be true because it was on the internet. They said that the idea, and it was on PBS has been running these shows on the brain. So because it's PBS, I sort of have to think there might be a semblance of veracity there. But they said that we used to say you only use like a small portion of your brain.
It's only about 20% even in the most smartest people.
They're now changing that, Peter. They're now saying that's not true. We're discovering that we do use a lot more of our brain than they thought that we did. So who knows?
I still don't buy it.
I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Because they said if you could figure out a way like the Matrix to harvest your brain power, as a computing device, you would outclass every storage, the entire amount of storage you have in the entire world, just one brain.
If I only had a brain.
If I only had a brain.
Hey, so next week.
All right, that's it.
The hours communicate with flowers. Oh, dear God, I'm singing Bob Plass. Oh, I'm channeling Robert.
So next week, I don't have anything planned. The week after that, I don't have anything planned.
Oh.
I think I should. I should get my nose out of Premiere.
We need to go over to Nadim's and then have him back. Yeah. We need to go have lunch.
Oh,
Wait a second.
They got the senior buffet coming up, too.
I know. We're both going to miss
it. Yeah, we're both going to miss it.
Oh. I'm going to be at a funeral, and Kenny's going to be busy.
Oh, I'm sorry, Peter.
I have two of them in 2 days, one in Maine and one in Massachusetts.
Oh, dear.
Back to back.
I'm very sorry.
Having said
that. Look out, here comes Harry.
Oh, here he is.
Okay. All right. Don't look him in the eye either.
I don't make eye contact.
So we're going to go out with the jam song now. The jam song is a collection of all types of call signs and jock shouts.
Let the announcer explain it.
I'm lining it up for how it relates to this show. Okay. So it all comes down.
I don't know what relates to this show, Ken.
The announcer explains it all.
Right.
I have no idea.
This is all old radio call signs. And this definitely was not radio the last 2 hours. That's what I'm getting at.
All right.
Yes, it was.
All right. Mm-hmm. Jam song.
In the mid-80s, it seemed as if jingles were everywhere.
Zork Furball Andromeda.
Zork Furball.
We decided to capture the moment by making a song that was all about our jingles. The jam song took about 3 weeks to record, partly because we wanted to make sure that it would be an accurate time capsule. Each station's name was sung with the correct logo melody and vocal group to match its most recent jingle package. We pressed the jam song as a record. It was sent out as a promotional item never intended for airplay. Several stations played it anyway. But for most stations, it just became a collector's item, something to turn up loud and listen to in the production room. Even though some of the stations and formats have changed over the years, it's still fun to hear. So one more time, now with CD quality, enjoy the jam song.
Singing up and down the dial. Like 2XS, say it.
Zorb Verbal! 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 Zorb Verbal!